Welcome. We'll start with the very first chapter of history that talks about the rise of nationalism in Europe. Now, in the previous lectures, we have seen how the various developments took place and how things worked around. Today, we would try to understand how the feeling of nationalism arose in Europe, and that feeling of nationalism in Europe was one of the leading grounds for the development of the nationalism in the regions of Indochina and in the neighboring regions of India and other nations as well. So let's start with one of the paintings that had been depicted by Soryu during that time. And of the four prints, one of the print talked about Statue of Liberty. Statue of Liberty represents a torch of enlightenment in one hand and the Charter of Rights of the man on the other hand, and it talks about removing the absolutism and the symbols of absolutism during that time. So we were looking for a kind of utopian world, which is an ideal society that could be built, and those were the kind of feelings that were prominent among the people. So the idea was, for example, in France you had the revolutionary tricolor, in Germany you had the black, red and golden flag, and Switzerland and US were already forming nation states during that time. So under nation state, what we talk about is a sense of unity, a sense of a developed culture where you are trying to struggle for independence and there is a kind of commonness or unity among the people for a common cause. So that's what is the idea of nation state. Under this, Renan wrote What is Nation, and he talked about nation as a culmination of long past of endeavors, sacrifices and devotion. That's a kind of very important statement that you should know. Now, when it comes to French Revolution in class 9th, as we already have studied French Revolution in detail, some of the findings from there are, we talked about the concept of fatherland and the citizen, that talked about or emphasized a commonness or unity and equality of rights. We talked about the new tricolor flag in France. We talked about how estate generals were elected. There was a centralized administration system. The internal custom duties were abolished. A uniform system of weights and measures were released, and a common currency. So those two developments are very important. These were the developments that took place under Napoleon. So initially you had the Bourbon rule or the monarchy that was collapsed. Democracy was brought in. Then Napoleon came in. Despite of the spread that Napoleon had, and you had the Napoleonic wars that took place, the Civil Code of 1804, the few important things that he brought about was a uniform system of weights and measures, a uniform currency. The second important thing that he brought about was improved transportation, and third was abolition of serfdom and the feudal system. Now, in that region, French became a common language and the local dialects were given less importance or discouraged. Jacobean clubs were established across the region, and Jacobean clubs were the places where liberal ideas or liberal movements were flowing. So developments under Napoleon initially, as we said, were good. They led to development of the region. Initially, the measurement of the cloth was done in the unit of Ely, and that Ely varied from Frankfurt to the other cities as well. So there was a difficulty in having a commonness or a common system. Similarly, there were 30 currencies which were later reduced to only 2 currencies. So those were definitely positive developments, but later on Napoleon turned hostile and the neighboring countries were trying to contain the French aggression. As a result, Warsaw, Holland and Switzerland acted as harbinger of liberty, and when the Napoleon was turning hostile, his rule was suppressed by the various powers, and you had the Congress of Vienna that was signed in 1815. So that was the fall of Napoleon ultimately. And during this time you had Greek struggle that gained momentum, and finally unification of Italy and Germany are very, very important for this chapter and very, very important to understand. So since we are talking about nationalism in Europe, the major countries would be the French Revolution, the unification of Germany, unification of Italy, and the revolt in the Balkan region. So in the Balkan region, which was mainly the Habsburg Empire of Austria and Hungary, you had people from different ethnicity following different languages and different cultural groups. A list has been given here. Now, the peasants who were there in the north, the south, the east and the west belonged to different ethnic groups, and the dominant class on this group, on this continent, was only the landed aristocracy, which had a common way of living, had mutual ties in terms of marriage, in terms of business, and that was even across the countries in Europe during that time. But this aristocracy was very small, or very few people were part of it. As far as Europe is considered, it was divided into two, the West and the East. West had small landowners, however, under East, you had large estates that were part of the Eastern Empire. The Western and the Central Europe started with the industrial production, which we will talk about more in chapter 5 in detail. And industrialization started in England, later on in France and Germany as well. During that time, you had a feeling of liberalism. For the liberalism, the word liber comes from Latin, that means free. So it talked about freedom of the people, freedom of the individual, and bringing in more equality. Also, universal system of adult suffrage was talked about, and initially only people with property had the right to vote. Later on in the democratic setup, every male above the age of 21 had the right to vote. However, under Napoleon, again the rights were limited and were reduced for women as well. So those were the kind of developments that came up and down in the region of France. As we already talked about Napoleon and his developments in the region, you also had the custom union, or the Zollverein, that was formed, that was an initiative of Persia and was joined by most of the German states. So this was again an important initiative where you had the number of currencies that were reduced. Again, one important philosophy during that time was the conservatism. Conservatism talked about containing the culture, containing the traditions along with modernity. So bringing in modernization was one of the aspects, but along with the modernization, the idea was to maintain the tradition, maintain the culture, the customs, and therefore the change would only be a gradual change. It would never be a drastic change. So that was the basic idea that was prevalent after 1815, that's after the fall of Napoleon during that time. And Treaty of Vienna was signed. Under this treaty, Britain, Russia and Prussia along with Austria defeated Napoleon, and the region in which the expansion of France could be done, or the Napoleon expansion was done, was limited during that time. So the north-south extensions have been given here. Now, the next was the idea for revolutionaries. So, as we said, liberalism was gaining momentum. Similarly, was Mazzini. Mazzini was an Italian. He was born in Geneva and he was the member of Carbonari Secret Society. He was exiled for the revolution of that took place in Liguria, and he formed two important societies, the Young Italy in Marsilius and Young Europe in Bern. Now, when he was forming these societies, he explained that God had intended nations to have natural boundaries, and those should be maintained by the mankind, and we are working forward towards a unified code or a unified system. So his idea was working for the unification of Italy. Italy during that time was divided into seven different states. Papal state and Sardinia was one of those. Sardinia had a constant fight, and Sardinia ultimately defeated Austria during that time. So we'll talk about more when we'll talk about the unification of Italy later on. As we said, this was an age of revolutions that took place. Now, the upheaval that took place in France in 1830 is very, very important. You had Bourbon kings who restored to power but were overthrown by the liberal Louis Philippe. Now, his philosophy or his idea was liberalism should be developed in France, or the idea of equality should be promoted. It was rightly said during that time, if the France sneezes, the rest of the Europe catches the cold. So that was the dominance of France in Europe during that time. Again, you had, after Louis Philippe came to power, you had the July Revolution that sparked up. And this July Revolution not only affected the regions of France, but affected the neighboring countries. As a result, in Greece, you had the war for independence, and this war for independence was supported by the people who were living outside Greece, who belonged to Greece. And finally, the Treaty of Constantinople was signed, and Lord Brayan organized the fund for that. Later on, this Lord Brian died of fever in 1824, and finally in 1832 Greek was declared as an independent nation. Now the feeling of nationalism arose with the idea of romanticism. Under romanticism, the criticism was mainly for the science and reasoning, and the ideas of emotion, intuition and mystical feelings were gained momentum. So you had various paintings. One of the paintings was by the French painter Delacroix, who talked about the various incidences. Then you had the John N. Gottfried, who discovered German culture as Das Volk, that's for the common men, and Voges, that's the spirit of the nation that he talked about. Similarly, there were numerous collections of vernacular language that was discussed. Poland was partitioned by the great powers. Great powers during that time were considered as Britain, Russia and Austria. And music was the only thing that kept it alive. So Polish language was forced out and Russian language was imposed into the region. So Polish was only used for the church gatherings. Similarly, you had the developments for the music, for the operas, and Grimmy fairy tales by Jacob and William Grimm became very, very important during that time. This time you had 1830s. Now remember, this is 1830s, and in 1930s we will talk about Great Depression in chapter 4 in the same history section of class 10. The basic difference here is 1830 was very similar to what happened in 1930s. So under 1830 it was economic hardship in Europe. So half of the Europe had a very high population, most of them migrated to urban areas. Problems of overcrowding, slums developed in those regions. On the other hand, agriculture was perishing and agriculture was not doing good. So there was increase in the prices of the agricultural commodity, and peasants have to struggle because they were under the burden of the feudal dues and they were not able to pay the loans and the dues. As a result, there was lots and lots of unemployment that was seen in France, and Louis Philippe was forced to be removed or flee out, and National Assembly proclaimed a republic or granted suffrage to all people above 21 years again and granted them right to work. Similarly were the cases that were happening in Sicilia in the regions of Poland by the weavers. Now what were the revolutions of liberals during that time? As we said, similar to or motivated by the revolution of the French Revolution, you had Germany, Italy, Poland and Austria-Hungary Empire that gained momentum, and unification was an important aspect for Germany. So under Germany you had the German National Assembly that was formed in 1848 with 831 elected representatives. Now under this, Bismarck was one of the major proponents who led to unification of Germany. His idea was to have a common educational, legal and a kind of judicial system framework for Germany. During this time, the Frederick William IV, who was the king of Persia, rejected this and joined other monarchs to oppose the idea of elected assembly. The parliament was mainly dominated by the middle class and resisted the workers' demand, and the troops were called in. So women formed political associations and women came into power. Louise Otto Peters was one of the women who founded the Women Journal and led the various feminist political associations during that time. So the basic idea was the serfdom and the bonded labor was abolished both in the Habsburg dominions and the Russian region. Now coming on to the making of Germany and Italy. As we said, initiative of the liberalism was the key idea for nation building during that time in Germany as well, and this was repressed by the monarchy that was prevalent there and the military, but it was supported by large landowners who were known as Junkers of Prussia. So Junkers of Prussia supported this movement, and finally this ended with the unification of Germany over three wars that took place in 7 years with Austria, Denmark and France, leading to the victory of Persia and the unification. And as we said, this was the region of Persia before 1866, and these were the various areas that were later on incorporated. Some of the regions like Austrian territory secluded themselves from the German Confederation. Now Italy, as we said, it was divided into seven regions. The Sardinia region was under the Italian princely house, And you had the Pope rule that was seen. Mazzini was one of the leaders who was working for the unification. So this is the map of Italy before unification and after unification. So the different seven states could be seen here. And you had various leaders who were working for the unification, and unified Italy was the basic idea. So under Victor Emmanuel II, the idea was to unify the Italy states over war. And the chief minister who was elected was Cavour. Now this Cavour was neither a revolutionary nor a democratic. He did not know Italian. He was a French speaker. He knew French better than Italian. And Sardinia, as we said, was defeated. Garibaldi was one of the major supporters of Mazzini. Garibaldi formed an army which was in the name of Red Shirts, and he marched to the south of Italy and the Kingdom of Two Sicilies, that's this region, and removed all the Spanish rulers from this region. So Garibaldi's contribution is very, very important. Here we have a kind of brief introduction about Garibaldi and his life. The next is the case of Britain. Again, very, very important. In Britain, you had English, Scot, Welsh, Irish as the different regions and the different cultures and traditions that were seen. So Act of Union 1707 between England and Scotland resulted in the formation of United Kingdom of Great Britain, and England was able to put its influence on Scotland. But what happened was Scotland's culture was later on suppressed. Catholics were suffering suppression because Catholics formed the majority of Scotland people, and Scotland Highlanders were again forbidden to speak their own native Gaelic language. So those were the things that happened, and finally Scotland was forcibly taken into the part of England. Similarly to Scotland, you had Ireland. In Ireland, you had Catholics and Protestants were trying to establish power over the Catholic nations. The Catholics were suppressed, and finally Ireland was incorporated into UK in 1801. So the symbol of New Britain was basically a British flag, a national anthem, and the English language that was actively promoted. Now, when we try to visualize the nations, it is a kind of figure. As we will see in chapter 3, we talked about a nationalism in India, and we have Bharat Mata as the figure. Similarly, here we have female figures or the allegory that have been the abstract ideas to represent the nation by person or things. So in France, you had Mérinie, and this Mérinie was basically characterized by the idea of liberty and republic, wearing of red cap, tricolor and cockade. So those statues were erected in public, seen on the coins during that time. Similarly, in German, you had Germania, and Germania was wearing a crown of oak leaves, which is dealing with heroism. So you have the various symbols and the significance of those symbols that have been given. The next, as we said, Balkans was a basic area. Now, this was the area where every nation had its eye on. So this nation, this region basically was formed by Romania, Bulgaria, Albania, Greece, Croatia, Bosnia, Slovenia and so on. And the people here were known as Slavs. So most of the Balkans was under during that time was under the Ottoman Empire of Turkey, and the spread of romantic nationalism and the disintegration of Ottoman Empire made this region a kind of explosive region where each and everyone was having their eyes on to try to control the Balkan area during the First World War. So the idea of nationalism and imperialism led this region into disaster. The nations colonized by the Europe began to oppose the imperialistic idea. Anti-imperialistic movements started, and those were mainly nationalist. Now, wherever you have the ideas of nationalism that cropped up, you had ultimately a victory over that, and a just society or nation states could be seen. So those were the things that happened under the chapter 1, where we have talked about nationalism in Europe. In the next chapter, we would be discussing nationalism in Indochina, and further next, we'll be talking about nationalism in India. Some of the important questions that could be formed from this section are, what was the important role of Bismarck and Garibaldi? What were the similarities in their ideology? How did the unification of Germany and Italy took place? What was the story that took place in the region of Balkan? Why this Balkan region was very, very important? Which all nations constituted the Balkan region, and which nations had the eye on the Balkan region? The findings from the French Revolution and how liberalism and romanticism was promoted under French Revolution. So those are the key highlights from this chapter. Stay tuned for further lectures on history. We'll be covering whole of the class 10th history as soon as possible. So stay tuned, do subscribe to the channel. Have a very good day ahead.